afternoon, good evening, wherever you're checking in from today. It's your guy again, the Nigerian Englishman on One Touch TV. And here is my post-match review. Apologies that I couldn't get the preview up earlier today. There's a few technicals. There's still a new channel, so sometimes these things happen. But I'm not going to dwell too much on that. Make sure you like, comment, share, and subscribe. Let's get things going. So, those who know about that James Brown song will know why I started this with that James Brown song. Because that's what we were on today. Straight revenge. They came for us and knocked us out of the FA Cup on the weekend. And we came for them in the league today. So I'm going to break a few things down. First of all, we'll go with the team selection. Team selection, I said everything that Arteta did in terms of predicted lineup, but the only differences I have were with, I didn't start David Luiz, I would have started Gabriel. I'm not too upset with the choice of that. Maybe he's not fully match fit. I talked about it earlier. Also, I didn't know that Tierney wouldn't be at this game, so I did pick Kieran Tierney. Cedric did a good job, but we'll go into that a little bit later. Right back, I didn't pick Hector Bellerin, because if Tierney was playing, I would have put Suarez and Tierney as my fullbacks. In the middle of the park, I got that right. I wasn't expecting him to start Pepe after such a terrible performance on the weekend. But it looked like it was a stroke of genius in terms of Mikel Arteta. So, in terms of the game, overall, I thought we started off very, very slowly. The game in general started off quite quickly. I mean, Southampton took an early lead, which was crazy. But I would say that was one of my few key moments in this game. The first key moment was Southampton taking the lead. The reason why was that was a key moment because it was the first Premiership game since we've been on our run of 5 games, 4 wins, conceded 1 goal and scored 13 goals. So this is the first time in that sequence of league games anyway that we've actually fell behind. So it was a good test. Not only are we going behind, we're going behind early. And you know about Arsenal, resilience is not something that you really attach to us as a football team, let's be honest. But straight away, the guy that I wasn't expecting even to be in the starting lineup comes up with a goal. Pepe actually scored a goal. After how much I abused the guy on the weekend, I think he saw it. Yeah, Nicholas, don't worry. I don't need thanks. But you watched my video, didn't you? You should have at least liked it or commented. I know you're checking it up on a ghost profile or something. Don't worry, I'm watching you. But great finish, great touch, great finish, great composure. So that was my, that in terms of key moments, us bouncing back so quickly after going 1-0 down, that was very, very key. The next key moment, I would say, next key moment was Emile Smith-Rowe getting injured. I hope the injury is not too serious because we're definitely going to need him in that United game on the weekend. But the reason why I said it was a key moment, because as a result of that, Pepe stayed on the pitch. Martinelli didn't get back on. And yeah, Willian came on the pitch again, guys. You know that guy that does nothing? Yeah, he came on the pitch. Arteta thought, he didn't obviously watch my video. He thought, give him a run. Black Sideshow Bob comes on and something crazy happens. He has a goal involvement. And I'm sure I'm probably giving him a little bit too much credit because it was his running down, chasing the ball, that gave the opportunity for Cedric. And then Cedric, what a ball through to Saka. Gives a touch. I mean, no, it doesn't even take a touch. He takes it on the half volley and his right foot right in the path of Lacazette. And that's 3-1, end of the game. The third key moment was the free kick. I don't believe it was a free kick personally, but I highlighted him as one of our danger men, one of the people that we should be worried about in this game. James Ward-Prowse. I mean, he scored the most free kicks in the Premier League this season. Only person in the Premier League for a couple of years now that scored two free kicks in the same game. So I was definitely worried as he was stepping up for that free kick, sizing it up, because 3-2 with, 8 to 10 minutes to go, I think, was left. That's a little bit more nerve-wracking, especially away from home, especially with how we've been this season. You know, it would have been a bit nerve-wracking. But big Bern Leno, he's been super criticised throughout the season, but he came up trumps, saved the free kick, secured the 3 points, game over. Revenge is sweet. So it looks like the aspect of resting players on the weekend worked in Arteta's favour today. I still don't agree in terms of how we were knocked out of probably the only cup we can actually win this season, but I guess it worked out because we did win the game. Now, let's go into player ratings. So with Bern Leno, I think he did everything. He didn't have much to do today, but I think everything that we asked of him, he did very well. I don't think he was at fault for the goal. It was a very well-worked set piece by Southampton. Where their two most dangerous players throughout today combined. I think Ward-Prowse passed it through to Armstrong, 1-0 to Southampton. Other than that, well, I don't think he was at fault. It was a great set piece, great strike. So I'll give Leno a 7. The centre-backs, we had David Luiz. He's not even the black side shirt, Bob. He's the original. So you can imagine a calamity having Willian down the middle in front of David Luiz, who's down the middle. So, yeah, a whole lot of cartoon characters in our squad today. Luiz, I wouldn't have picked him myself, and I guess I was right because he didn't do loads. He had a stinker, to be honest. I'm gonna give him a 5. He had a few dodgy incidents. One at the halfway line. One when he was a little bit of confusion with Leno, but he definitely should have been switched on. Lucky for his sidekick, Rob Holding, who I'm gonna give a 7 today. Who's kind of a little bit of an unsung hero. I won't lie. I've been very harsh on him of late because I remember in the Wenger days, I think after the FA Cup game against Chelsea, everyone was singing his praises as he's the next big thing. He's going to be the closest thing we have since Tony Adams, And I didn't get caught up in the hype. And he's been very, very up and down. But I think actually having a bit of confidence from the manager, like Arteta, and him getting games constantly, he's slowly building up a good reputation for himself, and who knows, come the summer, if he continues like this, he could be in contention for an England call-up. You never know. I'll definitely give him a 7. In terms of Xhaka in the middle of the park, I'd give him a 6. Wasn't his best game, wasn't his worst game. He didn't really do much wrong, but I just don't think he did very much. So I'll give him a 6. For Emile Smith Rowe, I like that guy. No, I definitely like that guy. I'm not caught up in the hype like everyone else as I keep talking about him. But what I like about Smith Rowe is he just he plays on the half turn, number one. And the difference between him and someone like a Willian down the middle or a Ceballos down the middle is his quick thinking. So Bias needs like 75 shots before he decides what he wants. 75 touches, sorry, before he decides what he's going to do. Whereas a Smith Rowe, he's already decided what he's going to do before the balls come to him. I mean, working with and training with the likes of Mesut Ozil has definitely benefited on him. And he's taken some good things. His movement is good. He kind of nearly always makes the right decision. He doesn't keep the ball for longer than it needs to be. If it needs to be a one-touch pass, he's ready to do it one touch. He needs to take on a man, he's ready to do that. He tracks back a bit, and he's always inside the pockets looking for openings, looking to create space, looking to be an outlet for his teammates. So in terms of Smith Rowe, I think I'll give him a 7-2. Partey didn't play the full game. Looked like he had a little bit of a cramp. I hope he'll be ready for the United game. Again, world class. He doesn't even have to do much. He just makes it look blissful. Party after party. I can't wait till you score so I can do that party, man. Get with it. But again, another great solid performance from him. I believe he's definitely one world-class player that we have in our squad. Like he can do everything with the ball. So I'll give him a 7. On the wings, Pepe. He got himself a goal. Can't knock that. He got himself a goal. Nice touch, nice goal. Something really funny happened. He was supposed to be subbed off for Martinelli before Smith Rowe got injured. And he was strolling off very slowly, so he ended up getting a booking. But because Smith Rowe got injured, instead of him going off, instead of Pepe going off, Smith Rowe went off and he stayed on for a little bit. And he strangely looked really, really lively for that second part before he actually went off. He looked very lively, good touches, few nutmegs here and there. He was doing the things that got us excited about Pepe in the first place. You remember the first couple of games he played last season? I think one of them was against Liverpool where he made Van Dijk look like a ghost. And I think his debut, I'm not sure, it might have been against Burnley, I'm not 100%. But the few flicks and tricks that we saw then, like, we got to see them again tonight. And with Pepe, he just needs to put his head down and keep working hard. Did he benefit playing on the left? Maybe him on the left might be something to build his confidence back, because on the right of our midfield, or the right wing forward, is someone who's, mate, there's too many words I can say about this guy. I wouldn't get caught up in his world class just yet, but he keeps improving week in, week out. Actually, I didn't even give Pepe a rating. I give Pepe a 7, by the way. But that leads me very, very swiftly into the man of the moment. Everyone's getting caught up with this Emile Smith Rowe and our next great hope, when we've clearly had our most consistent performer this season being Bukayo Saka. The guy is an animal. He's everywhere. It doesn't help that he looks like 12 years old, but it doesn't matter. He's making them look, making it look like he's the oldest and most mature player on the pitch. He's decision making, he can use both feet, he got a goal and an assist, and the way he took the goal today was really, really good, because if you see the first touch, he was kind of knocked off balance, but he was composed enough to take the shot quickly, not take too many touches and dwell on it a lot like some other players, especially young up-and-coming players who don't have the experience. He put it away. With the assist for Lacazette, he didn't waste time. Half volley, right foot, right in the path of Lacazette. 3-1, end of the game. For me, Saka, man of the match. 9 out of 10 for Saka. Like, he can only keep growing and growing and growing. It's only a matter of time till Southgate has to play him as an England regular. He does everything. He's now added goals to his game. I mean, the future is bright for Bukayo. It's only a shame that he'll be playing for Niger, because we definitely could have done with a player like him. He might be underutilized at England. They're spoilt for choice when it comes to the wingers right now. So it would have been nice, but hey, he chose, not me. He's still a top player as he plays for my club, Arsenal. And down the middle, Lacazette scored one. Great assist for Saka's goal as well. He's probably one senior player that's massively benefited from the injection of youth in our team. Massively. He just looks like a different player. I mean, he's so important to the side right now. I was speaking to my guy, Fifth Money. I might get him on the show at some point in the next couple of weeks. He was saying that, I said Saka and Tierney are the first two names on the sheet. He argued with me that it was Lacazette because of his link-up play, how he holds up the ball, how he brings other players in. And I laughed at it when he said it first. I still don't think he should be the first player on the team sheet, but he's definitely in the top five because he's having an absolute blinder. I mean, I think one of the things he's benefiting from with the youngsters is they can do the running for him. And he's definitely taking a father figure approach, because I think I was saying in my last video how Smith Rowe talked about how the person that's really gelled him into the side and made him feel at home and comfortable is Lacazette. Also, Saka talks about him in a great way. Senior players like Aubameyang, we know about their relationship. So Lacazette is really doing well right now as our top scorer. And I think the biggest benefit for Lacazette is because other players in the team are contributing with goals, the pressure on him to score isn't as high as it was earlier in the season. I mean, with the way we were playing, we weren't creating a ton of chances like we're doing right now. I mean, we're actually having a lot more clear-cut chances. I talked about it towards the back end of last season. We're going to suffer at some point because on our FA Cup run and the last few fixtures of last season, we were super, super clinical, whereas Aubameyang needed one or two chances and he was going to score one or two goals. That's literally how it worked out. And I kept saying, like, let's not get into this habit and relinquishing possession in every single game and relying on being clinical, because we can't keep that consistency of having three chances in a game and scoring two goals. It's not realistic that we can maintain that, which is why we had such a struggle at the start of the season. But now it appears that we're creating more clear-cut chances, which is what I'm really excited about, which definitely is a result of Saka and Emile Smith Rowe working and linking up together. But also other people other than Laka and Aubameyang are chipping in with goals and chipping in with key moments. So I think in terms of going forward, setting up to the game on the weekend, I guess this is the best shape we could have been in. I mean, we've had 6 games, 5 wins, 1 draw, conceded 2 goals. I mean, it's not a bad record. I'm not under the illusion that Arsenal can finish in the top 4 or even the top 6. I mean, I've always said top 8, and if we can have a good Europa League run now, that'd be some form of salvage in our season. But we got the scumbags on the weekend, United. Yeah, we're coming into that game with a good win. Hopefully they get dealt with tomorrow. I'm not sure who they're playing tomorrow, but I'm definitely gonna be I guess kind of looking forward-ish to the game. Well, I don't know, to be honest. I won't be looking forward to playing them right now because they're on really, really good form. The confidence is high. They've just beaten the champions. They were top of the league until tonight, with City have taken over. I do think City are going to win the league long term, but they're doing their thing. Pogba decided to play football, but I'm going to save all this Man U talk for the preview on Friday. I'm definitely going to have a guest on it, so look out for it. And just again, thank you everyone for all the engagement, the interaction. Thank you for the pointers as well. Make sure you're liking, sharing, commenting, subscribing. Have some fun with me. It's a new channel and we're just excited about it growing, okay? So, hope you enjoyed today. See you on Friday.